All right. Good morning. This is Kaz, and you are joining us today for another edition of Celebrity Stopover, where we give you a real-time update on your favorite celebrities because they are with us today and they're stopping over. Now, today it's a special edition, actually, of Stopover because we will be joined by some of the prime movers in the world of European cinema by way of Cine Europa 24 this 2021. Now, they may not be celebrities or artists that you have in your head, but the films that they are showcasing this year are certainly are and deserve the recognition that they have garnered this far. Now, first up, we have the head of the Political Press and Information Section Delegation of the European Union to the Philippines, Ms. Ana Isabel Sanchez Ruiz. And next, we also have the Charge Affairs of the Embassy of the Republic of Poland. And I do hope, sir, that I pronounce your name right. Please correct me if I am not. Mr. Jaroslaw Szczepankiewicz. Would that be right? Or almost? Hold on. We're adding him again to the screen. To the stream, that is. Okay. So once again, we are welcoming back onto the stream Charged Affairs of the Embassy of the Republic of Poland, Mr. Jaroslaw Szczepankiewicz. I hope I'm saying that right, sir.
Oh, hi.
All right. A pleasant good morning to all of you. Bonjour, buenos dias, and dzień dobry.
Right.
So thank you for joining us today. Before we get on to the questions, may I congratulate all of the countries, and of course you as well, who have participated in this incarnation of Cine Europa. Now, given what everyone had to bear and go through during this pandemic, the journey for sure has been a product of hard work, patience, and I can imagine sheer commitment to the European cinema. So let's begin by introducing Cine Europa to our viewers. Now, some of the viewers may not know, but some of the viewers are actually yearly supporters of Cine Europa. So if someone were to ask you, someone who knows nothing about Cine Europa, how would you define and explain Cine Europa to someone who doesn't know anything about it?
Well, Cine Europa is a film festival that we organize at the EU delegation to the Philippines together with our member states and cultural institutes based in the Philippines. We organize this every year since the last 24 years. So mm-hmm. it has already become a bit of an institution, I think, among the Filipino film lovers. And of course, this was a classical film festival with very recent movies that are still in the commercial circuits in Europe and other parts of the world, with physical screenings. But of course, with COVID last year, we had to change the format. So this year is the second time that we do it online. We mm-hmm. have tried to reproduce a bit the experience of registering, booking your ticket, and watching a movie at a certain schedule, so and choosing your movie. So that's a bit similar to a cinema experience, and less the previous years is always free. I must say you have to register, but there is no cost involved.
Very good, very good. Everyone will be happy to know that you can watch the movies for free. You can be culturally educated for free. I was checking the website and wanted to see how far back Cine Europa has been celebrated here in the Philippines. I was surprised to see that it started, well, based on the website, Cine Europa 6. So what happened to the Cine Europa 1 to 5?
Lucas, don't ask me those things. I just arrived in Manila. I'm going to research that. It's a mystery, I guess. There must be a good reason, but I'm sure the festival took place indeed since 98, actually, when you celebrated the 100th anniversary of the Philippine independence.
The world has certainly changed since last year, and since technology has certainly made the world smaller because of online meeting and discussions, like what we're doing today. How relevant for you is cinema to the lives of people today who are facing the pandemic and technological advancement?
I don't know if Jaroslaw wants to step in on that one. For me, it means a bit of evasion. You can, for a couple of hours, you can live other lives in different places with different yes. people. So that's the main thing, especially very important now that we are all stuck with our close family members in one room or one house. It's very important to travel a bit, even if it's just with your brain.
Exactly. And for those people who dream to go to Poland, dream to go to Mexico, to France, to Europe, to Belgium, to Brussels, at least watching these films, they will feel that they have taken a trip, even if it's just 2 hours or 2 hours and a half. As far as participating countries go, was there an increase in the number of countries that participated this year? As compared to, let's say, last year? And how does, let's say, a country become part of the list? Do they audition in some way?
This year we have 17 movies from 15 European member states, European Union member states. So, and some of the movies are co-productions between mm-hmm. several countries. Last year, it was slightly more. We have 19 movies from 20 European countries. And part of the movies come from the European Union repository of movies that we select, and part mm-hmm. of them are selected by our member states here. So, indeed, there can be movies that are... there can be several movies, I mean, from the same country or from a co-production of different European countries.
Yes, like this year, there's a movie that is co-produced by Luxembourg and Spain, right? Can one country submit more than one film? Or it's just one film per country?
It's one film per country, but the more films, the better. I must say, with the online screening, it's been a bit difficult sometimes mm-hmm. To obtain the movies because the filmmakers are worried about their copyrights.
And yes.
This format is easy to copy illegally the content. So in some cases, it has been a bit difficult to convince the filmmakers to allow the showcase of their movies.
Right. You mentioned preserving copyright. I'm sure that Cine Europa has its own fail-safe way to make sure that this does not happen. But I can only imagine that it has been a challenge since last year in going online and doing this and providing this online. How different would Cine Europa 24 be from other film festivals? Is there anything that you do different here that that other countries are doing differently as well?
I think the fact that it's free may be a difference. I'm not sure, but I think that's something specific. The fact that it's European movies, so that's something. Maybe our colleague Jaroslaw wants to step in here.
To Jaroslaw?
Repeat the question, because I'm just thinking about, you know, previous.
Okay. My question was, how different is Cine Europa from other European film festivals? Is there anything that you do different here than, let's say, when you do a similar European film festival in a European country?
Yeah, I think that yes. Because, you know, the people have a kind of the Philippines quite blurry image of Europe, which mm-hmm. seems to be very unified. Of course, we have the, I would say, same references. We have a kind of the same problems, but answers for this problem different in different European culture. So we can have on the same issue in the European Union, even from the, I would say, artist point of view, the value that you try to project, completely different opinion. We are witnessing it internally as well as a group. So it is enormous richness. It's a kind of unity in diversity.
Yes.
So looking at this cinema, you can have a quite different approaches to the same subject. So it's not monolithic. So I think, as for a European, the every European movie I can read easily, to certain limits, to understand Spanish culture, for example, or French one. But of course, I am always making my own dialogue with this artist, with this director, but as way with the cultural way approaching the subject. I think this is, for Europe, it's unique, this possibility to have it. So it's a kind of the open space for a dialogue on art. And I think for this reason, art in Europe is flourishing.
Yes, it is. And we're happy that the local audiences here, local film buffs, local moviegoers, are able to experience Europe from a different set of eyes. And at the same time, you get to educate us Filipinos about how the culture of Spain is, how the culture of Poland is, how the culture of France is. And it's all one big school. But yep. You use cinema in order to get your message across. Given what the arts had to go through in order to be seen and heard and shared, do you think this online screening, if in case the cinemas still do not open until, let's say, heaven forbid, next year, do you think you will still continue on with the online? And if in case the cinemas do open, will you keep the online element continuing on, even if it is being shown in the cinemas?
We will definitely continue. Next year will be our silver anniversary.
Yes, silver. You have to
continue. We cannot miss that one. And I think as soon as circumstances allow, we would go back to our touring of the country with physical showing of the movies in cinemas, because that's also an important aspect of Cine Europa, that it allows us to forge partnerships with local communities, with commercial entities, with academia. So we are really longing for that closer contact. As regards a possible hybrid format, we have to examine that. There are some difficulties because in this case, when the movies are shown online, we get electronic files. We get one electronic copy, while in the other case, you get the copy in a different format.
Yes.
As I said, the filmmakers are a bit worried of disseminating many copies of their movies. So that's something we will have to examine, but definitely we would like to go back to the physical film festival as soon as possible.
All right. In short, you will cross the bridge when you get there. Now, while we may not have enough time to completely do a run-through of all the films, as all information can be read and gleaned from the website, that's www.cineeuropaph.com. I'd like to ask about some of the film titles that caught my eye and piqued my curiosity. So let's start with the Polish film, The Lure. Can you give us an idea, or for those who have not gone through the website, what the film is all about? Mr. Jaroslaw? Oh no. Okay. Internet connection. Okay, we will come back to that, and we will ask Mr. Jaroslaw about the that particular film. But wait, is he back again? Okay, he's there again. That's the fun thing of doing this live. So, as I was saying, Mr. Jaroslaw, we don't have enough time to completely do a run through of all 17 films, but there are some films that have piqued my curiosity. I'd like to start with the Polish film, The Lure. Can you give us an idea of what the film is all about? The entry from Poland, yes.
I missed the last
The question. Point. Okay.
Yeah.
Can you tell us something about Poland's entry this year? The film that's called The Lure?
So, you know, every year, you know, of participation in the cinema, we try to learn how to reach Filipino audience, to try to find, I would say, the better entry point. Sometimes we think that what we are pleased looking at, it's completely, there is no correct reading of the movie. It happened because of the cultural interest, audience and the director. So there is a constant, you know, with the Cine Europa, constant work in progress to find the best proposition. But it's a very, you know, mercantile approach, but it's a normal, you know, that you want to attract your audience. This year we present Agnieszka Smoczyńska movie The Lure, and Smoczyńska is very often taken as a director for Netflix series, and this is her debut in the cinema. It's a kind of the urban fable for adults, and it's feminist fable and beautiful. And here you have kind of the link, because she played very well this link between painting and the cinema. She's heavily basing the shooting on the paintings of the Polish painter Aleksandra Waliszewska. It's a little bit horror, you know, painting, but I think that she was very attracted by her painting. So you can see in many European movies this kind of the inspiration. It's not only the subject, you know, that sometimes a painting is a subject of the movie, but as well the way how director is approaching, you know, making movie. Because always cinema and painting are very close. And this movie is a musical. This is...
that would be nice. It's a musical.
And it's, I would say, interesting because Smoczyńska grow up in dancing clubs herself. So they try to recreate the world of her childhood, simply. It was a cheap world, you know, full of light, glamour, kitsch music. So it was the reality in the 80s in Poland. It was the time of ABBA, you know, Bonnie M, so this kind of the things. So that brought a kind of the... this band brought a kind of the pop, you know, culture to the dancing clubs. So this is a film about the reality. And of course, it's exaggerated and saturated with melancholy and longing. So it's two things, horror and musical. So it is good, I think, mixture. I think that this movie is very Smoczyńska had a lot of courage to make this film, you know, in this way. She took a lot of risk as a director. And she was, I think, aware of balancing on the border of the kitsch. Mm-hmm. But I think what she mastered, even sometimes I can see the weak point in the movie, but she managed to use the kitsch as artistic material. Okay. So it's very difficult for a director use the kitsch, but not making the kitsch movie, because often it's opposite.
You get a different result if it's too kitsch, yes.
So using the kitsch as material for building the movie is quite something quite original and very courageous. And for the debut, it's something that impressed to go in that direction. Because for a young director, it could finish catastrophe, but she managed to do good film.
We're glad that she managed it. And as you said, combined horror and musical. That will be an interesting movie to watch. That's for sure. Yeah.
Bought her a ticket to Netflix, you know.
yes, we definitely will. We will send out the information, of course, within the interview. And everyone who is interested in checking out Cine Europa can check it out on the website, cineeuropaph.com. But next on my list is the Spanish film, El Cuadro, which is in English called The Painting. What can you tell us about the film, Miss Anna?
Well, the movie is more a documentary than a film, but it's a documentary with trying to introduce a bit of mystery in examining this very famous painting from Diego Velázquez, Las Meninas. So this is a masterpiece from the Baroque centuries. And it's a very unusual painting because you have the painter who is painting himself and at the same time is painting an audience to the king and the queen that you only see reflected on a mirror, but you can imagine that he was painting a portrait of them. So it's a bit of a game, this painting. And you have also a character on the background coming from a room that you don't know what it is. It's a very interesting documentary that is very pedagogical in the sense that you learn a lot about art and about the times as well, history. Not a movie in classical terms, but interesting and worthwhile watching anyway.
Do you have to be a painter or a lover of art to enjoy El Cuadro, that is? And hopefully after watching it, can anyone be inspired to want to take up painting?
Well, my impression was that painting looks like a very difficult thing to do, especially after watching this masterpiece. So I don't know if that would encourage people to paint, or more of the opposite, say, oh my God, I could not be that good. I think it's a good documentary for those who are not interested by painting or art. Mm-hmm. And it may initiate some people into that, thinking, well, a painting has many things behind, many interpretations, many theories, a historical context, and maybe people who don't like paintings, they haven't thought of all those aspects that make it more exciting. So I think it's good for, especially for those who are new to that.
Me too, I think so too. There's also another film that got me curious. This is the Austrian film called Eric and Erica. which tells the true story of Eric Schinniger, who is a world champion skier. It tells his life as a woman and his struggle for recognition and acceptance as a transgender. How important was it to have a film like this that chronicles the life of one of the members of the LGBTQ plus community to be part of Cine Europa this year?
For us, it was very important. As you know, the European Union is a big defender of equal rights for everybody, irrespective mm-hmm. of sexual orientation or any other circumstances in your life. So in particular, in this case, the LGBTQI community. So I think that's a movie that reflects a bit the values that we stand for. We also have other movies a bit in the same sense of giving voice to people who should enjoy equal rights, and unfortunately sometimes it's not the case. For instance, the Swedish movie Catwalk, giving voice to people with disabilities. We have also movies with an environmental message in the festival, like The Warden or Que Arde or A Casa. So yeah, these are values that we keep very close to our hearts and that we promote in our political activities, but also through this film festival.
Right. Speaking of communities, this festival is, you can say, a community of sorts in itself. So what does Cine Europa hope to achieve this year as compared to the previous Cine Europas?
Well, of course, we hope to reach or even go over the number of viewers. So last year we had 6,000, it's close to the 50,000 that nice. We attracted when we were touring the country. But I hope this year more people will enjoy our movies.
We will keep our fingers crossed for that and make sure it happens. All right. So just a quick recap, Cine Europa 24. It is, of course, the 24th year, the 24th edition. You will be celebrating your 25th year next year. Advance congratulations. And for this year, it has films from different European countries, 17 films participating from the Czech Republic, from Sweden, from Spain, Poland, Belgium, Hungary, Denmark, Greece, Italy, the Netherlands, Austria, Romania, Finland, Germany, Luxembourg, and France. And for those who are interested in watching the films, you need to go to cineeuropaph.com. That is where you can register, right, for free. And then after registering, I think there is a schedule of films to be shown per day.
And I must add that from the 17th of September, those who have registered, they can access, they can review the movies of their choice, all of them, if they want, any at any moment, day or night.
So oh, wonderful.
Schedule showings until the 16th of September, and for the second part of the month, it's just open to everybody who has registered.
Well, it will be like Netflix. You can watch any time of the day. You can watch until 3 a.m. or start watching at 3 a.m.
Exactly.
And be absent from work the next day.
No, not that.
Well, thank you, Ms. Anna and Mr. Jaroslaw, for joining us today. I'm sure that this little talk that we have at least increased everyone's curiosity about Cine Europa and also European cinema. And hopefully when we get to talk in next year, hopefully the cinemas will be open and we can talk to one another in the same room and where we have more ideas to bounce off each other. And congratulations to Cine Europa 24. Advance congratulations for Cine Europa 25. And we're glad that you are here to take this initiative. And it is nice to meet both of you. And hopefully I will meet more members of Cine Europa as time progresses on. All right. So till the next celebrity and movers in arts, that we get to talk to that passed our doors, or this time around virtually. This has been Kaz for Celebrity Stopover here on All Hits. Mellow 94.7 sounds good. Bye, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Salamat.
Salamat.